Mon nom est Benoît Dupont, je suis le directeur du Centre international de criminologie comparée. Je voulais vous remercier à tous d'être venus. Nous sommes très heureux et très honorés d'accueillir Steven Pinker. We're very happy and very honored to welcome today Mr. Pinker. I was telling him that we've probably had never so many people attend our scientific launch in the 5 or 6 years we organized it. So you were attracting obviously big crowds. Monsieur Pinker est extrêmement connu. Time Magazine le place dans la liste des 100 intellectuels les plus influents de la planète. Prospect Magazine, I think, puts you, ranks you number 3rd of the most influential thinkers. Another website lists you among the 25 living major atheists on the earth. And I'm sure that there are many, many other very prestigious rankings to which you belong. Vous êtes ici pour nous parler de votre ouvrage The Better Angels of Our Nature, et je souhaite qui n'est pas encore traduit en français, et je souhaite beaucoup de chance aux traducteurs pour transcrire ce titre en langue française. Ça sera, je pense, un exercice relativement ardu. Dans cet ouvrage, vous analysez les tendances de diminution, réduction de la violence au cours des derniers millénaires. Donc c'est plutôt un ouvrage optimiste, n'en déplaise aux journalistes qui aiment bien dramatiser et qui aiment bien des narrations, des récits un petit peu plus catastrophistes. Et c'est un ouvrage également qui nous donne de l'espoir sur la nature humaine et également sur la capacité des institutions à justement amadouer cette nature humaine et à produire des réductions significatives de violences interpersonnelles. Et une des raisons pour lesquelles nous vous avons également invité, c'est le fait que vous utilisez dans cet ouvrage, bien que vous soyez professeur de psychologie à Harvard, vous mobilisez la philosophie, l'anthropologie, l'archéologie, la science politique et bien d'autres disciplines. Et ça correspond un petit peu à l'idéal transdisciplinaire du CICC, le Centre international de criminologie comparée, et de ses 40 chercheurs issus d'une douzaine d'universités québécoises et d'une demi-douzaine de disciplines, l'économie, le droit, la science politique, la sociologie, la psychologie, etc. Alors je vous remercie encore une fois d'être présent parmi nous. À la fin de votre présentation, nous aurons un cocktail qui sera offert à quelques mètres d'ici, et je voulais par avance m'excuser pour tous ceux qui n'ont pas le petit autocollant qui leur permettra de participer au cocktail, mais pour des raisons de sécurité, l'université nous a empêchés de pouvoir accueillir toutes les personnes qui sont présentes dans la salle aujourd'hui. Alors on s'en excuse par avance, mais c'est votre, je pense, notoriété qui a attiré beaucoup plus de monde que nous pouvions hélas en accommoder lors du cocktail. Alors sans plus attendre, je vous laisse la parole. The stage is yours. You've got about 1 hour to introduce your book.
I would like to thank the Centre for inviting me, and I, for reasons that will become apparent, you'll see that I am a big fan of the gathering of quantitative data on rates of violence. So I salute the effort that your centre engages in and the conference to which you've invited me here today. Believe it or not, and I know most people do not, violence has been in decline for long stretches of time, and today we may be living in the most peaceful era in our species' existence. The decline of violence has not been steady, it has not brought rates of violence down to zero, and it is not guaranteed to continue. But I hope to persuade you that it is a persistent historical development, visible on scales from millennia to years, from wars and genocides to the treatment of children and animals. I'm going to walk you through 6 major declines of violence, try to identify their immediate causes, that is, particular historical events of the era, and then try to tie them together in terms of their ultimate causes, that is, general historical forces interacting with human nature. The first major decline of violence I call the pacification process. Until around 6,000 years ago, humans everywhere lived in anarchy, without central government. What was life like in this state of nature? This is a question that thinkers have pondered for centuries. In 1651, Thomas Hobbes famously wrote that in a state of anarchy, the life of man is solitary, poor, nasty, brutish, and short. A century later, Jean-Jacques Rousseau countered that nothing can be more gentle than man in his primitive state. Now, neither of these men knew what they were talking about. They were speculating from the armchair. They had no data, but today we can do better because there are two sources of evidence on rates of violent death in non-state societies. The first is forensic archaeology. You can think of this as CSI Paleolithic. Namely, what proportion of prehistoric skeletons have signs of violent trauma, such as bashed-in skulls, decapitations, bones with arrowheads embedded in them, or mummies found with ropes around their necks? Here we see 20 estimates, and they span quite a range from zero up to about 60%. But the average of these 20 data sets is 15%. That is, 15% of skeletons have signs of unhealed violent trauma. Is that a big number or a small number? Well, let's compare it to those from some modern periods, such as the United States and Europe in the 20th century, whose rate of death from war is about 2/3 of 1%. The biggest estimate that you can get for the world as a whole, combining deaths from wars, from genocides, and man-made famines is about 3%. And the rate for the 21st century for the entire world is invisible. The bar is less than one pixel high at a rate of 0.03%. The second source of evidence on rates of violence in non-state societies comes from ethnographic vital statistics. The wave of settlement and government that swept over the world starting around 6,000 years ago left a few pockets of the world still in a state of anarchy, namely hunter-gatherer and hunter-horticultural and other tribal societies, and ethnographers who have lived with them for long stretches of time have tabulated their rates of death from various causes, including warfare. I found 27 of those estimates in the literature. Again, they span quite a range, but they average of 524 homicide deaths per 100,000 per year. Again, that means about 0.5% of the population is killed in war every year. Is that a big number or a small number? Well, again, we'll compare it to some modern societies, and I will stack the deck against modernity by picking some of the most violent societies in their most violent periods, like Germany in the 20th century, which went through two world wars and has a rate of 144 per 100,000 per year over the century. Russia in the 20th century, two world wars and a civil war with a rate of 126. Japan in the 20th century, which had a world war that ended in two nuclear strikes with a rate of 27. United States in the 20th century, two world wars and about half a dozen other foreign wars with a rate of less than 6. The world in the 20th century, again, looking at the largest possible estimate that includes deaths on and off the battlefield, deaths from genocide, deaths from man-made famines, and we have a rate of about 60. And here is the world in the 21st century. The rate, again, is less than one pixel high, a rate of about 0.3 of a war death per 100,000 per year. So not to put too fine a point on it, but when it comes to life in a state of nature, Hobbes was right, Rousseau was wrong. The immediate cause was the rise and expansion of states, leading to the various paxes that history students are taught about, the Pax Romana, Pax Islamica, Pax Hispanica, and so on, which indicate that when a state or empire gets control over a territory, they try to stamp out tribal raiding and feuding, not because they have a benevolent interest in the welfare of their citizens, but rather because tribal warfare is a nuisance to the emperors and kings, who would just as soon keep the people alive to supply them with taxes and soldiers and slaves. So just as a farmer has a selfish interest in preventing his livestock from killing each other, He doesn't care what they're fighting about, and it's just a dead loss to him. So the early kings and emperors tried to stamp out tribal violence within their borders. The second decline of violence can be appreciated by looking at this woodcut showing a typical day in the life in the Middle Ages. And the process that led to a reduction of this kind of mayhem has been called the civilizing process. Now, many of you in the studies of comparative and historical homicide know, in many parts of Europe, homicide statistics go back 800 years, and historical criminologists such as Manuel Eisner have plotted them over time. Here I've replotted his data on a logarithmic scale from a tenth of a homicide per 100,000 per year to 1 per to 10 to 100, and you can see there has been a massive decline of homicide in England from the year 1200 to the year 2000, so that a contemporary Englishman has about 1/35th the chance of being murdered compared to his medieval ancestors. This is true not just in England, but in every European country for which we have data. These data, again, are from Manuel Eisner. Here we have data for Italy, the Netherlands, Germany and Switzerland, and Scandinavia. Here we have the average of those five regions, and for the sake of comparison, I've also plotted the 524 per 100,000 per year rate for the tribal societies. So this gap here is what I call the pacification process, this further decline, the civilizing process. I took the name from the famous book by the German sociologist Norbert Elias, in which he argued that in the transition from the Middle Ages to modernity, there was a consolidation of central states and kingdoms out of the medieval patchwork of duchies and baronies and principalities. With it, criminal justice was nationalized, and the constant feuding and brigandage and warlording of the medieval knights gave way to the king's justice. Also during this period, there was a growing infrastructure of commerce. The development of financial institutions like money and contracts that could be recognized within the borders of the newly consolidated states, and improvements in the technological infrastructure of commerce, such as transportation and timekeeping. As a result, zero-sum plunder began to give way to positive-sum trade, and that is a point that I'll return to at the end of the lecture. The third decline of violence can be appreciated by remembering some of the ways that the early states and kingdoms enforced law and order within their borders, namely sadistic forms of corporal and capital punishment, such as breaking on the wheel, burning at the stake, clawing with iron hooks, sawing in half, and impalement. But in a process called the Humanitarian Revolution, country after country abolished the use of torture as a form of criminal punishment. Here we have a timeline of major countries that abolished judicial torture, and you can see that there was a wave of abolitions in the second half of the 18th century, including the famous prohibition of cruel and unusual punishment in the Eighth Amendment of the American Constitution, which took place right in the middle of this wave of abolitions. Also abolished during this period was the profligate use of the death penalty for non-lethal crimes. In 18th century England, there were 222 capital offenses on the law books, including poaching, counterfeiting, robbing a rabbit warren, being in the company of gypsies, and strong evidence of malice in a child 7 to 14 years of age. By 1861, the number of capital crimes had been reduced to 4. Likewise, in the United States in the 17th and 18th centuries, the death penalty was used for theft, sodomy, bestiality, adultery, witchcraft, concealing birth, slave revolt, and counterfeiting. In fact, this graph, which runs from 1650 to 2000 and shows the percentage of American executions for crimes other than murder, as you can see, in the colonial period, a majority of the executions were for crimes other than murder. Nowadays, the only crime other than murder that, for which the death penalty is used is conspiracy to commit murder. Now, of course, the United States is unusual even among Western democracies, even in having the death penalty. Most European countries have abolished it. Here we see a timeline for the number of European countries with capital punishment from 1775 to the present. And as you can see, the majority of the abolitions took place in the 20th century. But the blue timeline shows the number of European countries that actually put people to death. And it shows that well before the politicians got around to eliminating capital punishment from the law books, their countrymen had lost their taste for putting people to death. On average, about 50 years elapsed between the last actual execution and the time the politicians got around to eliminating it. But even in the United States, or I should say, even in 34 of the 50 states, the death penalty is a shadow of its former self. This graph shows the number of American executions per capita since the 17th century. And as you can see, the rate of execution has absolutely plummeted. Nowadays in the United States, about 40 people are put to death every year in a country that has more than 16,000 homicides per year. Also abolished during the Humanitarian Revolution were witch hunts, religious persecution, such as burning heretics, dueling among men of honor, blood sports like bear baiting, debtors' prisons, and most famously of all, slavery. Slavery used to be legal everywhere on earth. No one seemed to think there was anything wrong with it. The Bible had no problem with slavery. So-called democratic Athens was a slaveholding society. But starting in the second half of the 18th century, there was a trickle of abolitions that eventually swept over the world, culminating in 1980 when Mauritania became the last country on earth to abolish legal slavery. And so for the last 30 years, we've been living through a unique period in human history in which slavery has not been legal anywhere. What were the immediate causes of the humanitarian revolution? Could it be the rise of affluence? Perhaps as people become richer, their life becomes more pleasant, they put a higher value on life in general, and by extension, the lives of other people. The problem is that the timing doesn't work. If you look at a measure of affluence, such as per capita income in real dollars, you see that there was virtually no change in the 18th century when these humanitarian reforms started. The increase began in the 19th century with the Industrial Revolution, about 100 years later than the heyday of these reforms. Instead, the only exogenous cause that I've been able to identify for the advent of humanitarian reforms is the rise of printing and literacy. This graph shows that before the 18th century, there was a 25-fold increase in the economic efficiency of manufacturing a book. That efficiency was put into practice, and in the 18th century, there was an exponential growth in the number of books published per decade. And for the first time during the 18th century, a majority of people could read those books. That's when the literacy rate, at least for men, rose above the 50% mark. Why should literacy matter? Well, there's another name for this era. It's called the Enlightenment, because this is the age in which knowledge began to replace superstition and ignorance. And it's possible that a literate and educated populace is less likely to believe in nonsense, such as that the Jews poison the wells, heretics go to hell, crop failures are caused by witches, children are possessed by the devil, which has to be beaten out of them, Africans are brutish and fit only for slavery, and so on. And that's bound to undermine many official rationalizations for violence. As Voltaire said during this era, those who can make you believe absurdities can make you commit atrocities. Also, literacy is a technology of cosmopolitanism, of the mixing of people and ideas. And it's possible that as people consume more fiction and drama and history and journalism, they start to inhabit other people's minds. They imagine what is it like to be someone else, and that could expand their sense of empathy and decrease their taste for cruelty, idea that I will also return to at the end of the talk. The fourth decline of violence has been called the long peace, and it speaks to the frequently made assertion that the 20th century was the most violent in history. Now, people who make that claim never cite any numbers from any century other than the 20th, so this is a trend that's basically based on one data point. And there are reasons to doubt that it is true. The 19th century is often held out as a much more peaceful century than the 20th, but if you look carefully at the 19th century, it had the Napoleonic Wars, which killed 4 million people, one of the most destructive wars in European history. It had the most destructive civil war in history, the Taiping Rebellion, which killed 20 million people. The most destructive war in American history, the Civil War, which killed 650,000. In Africa, the conquests of Shaka Zulu, which killed maybe 1 to 2 million people. In South America, the War of the Triple Alliance killed 60% of the population of Paraguay, which makes it proportionally the worst interstate war in history. Then there were slave-raiding wars in Africa and imperial wars in Africa, Asia, and the South Pacific, whose death rates we can't even begin to calculate. Also, while it is certainly true that World War II was the single deadliest event in human history, it's not so clear that it was the worst event in terms of the percentage of the world's population that was affected at the time. This graph is taken from a man named Matthew White, who calls himself an atrocitologist, and who has a book called The Great Big Book of Horrible Things, including an appendix which lists the 100 worst things that human beings have ever done to each other. I've taken his list, I have scaled them by the population of the world at the time, and plotted them in a graph from 500 BCE to 2000. As you can see, history's worst atrocities were pretty evenly sprinkled over 2,500 years of human history. World War II comes in at ninth place, and World War I doesn't even make the top 10. Now, you can also see that the data cloud kind of funnel downward as you get close to the 20th century. Presumably, this does not mean that in ancient times they only committed really big atrocities, and more recently we've been committing big and medium-sized and small-sized atrocities, but rather this is a reflection of the historical record. The closer you get to the present, the more likely a war or atrocity would have been written down by a historian and survived to the present. We can zoom in on the last 500 years since the printing press and look at a data set on great power wars. These are wars between the 800-pound gorillas of the day, the countries and empires that can project force beyond their own borders. And over the last 500 years, first we see the percentage of years that the great powers fought each other. And it shows that in the first part of this era, the great powers were pretty much always at war with each other. That's just what great powers did. More recently, they've hardly ever been at war with each other. Here we have the duration of wars involving a great power, and again we see a decline. There used to be things called the 30 Years' War and the 80 Years' War and the 100 Years' War. The 20th century had the Six-Day War. Here we have the frequency of wars involving a great power, and there too there has been a decline in how many new wars were started each year involving a great power. But there is one trend that went in the opposite direction, and that is once a great power started a war, how many people was it able to kill per country per year? And because of advances in military organization and technology, wars became deadlier and deadlier until 1950, in which that measure showed a decline as well. So for the last two-thirds of a century, we've been living through in an era in which both the frequency and the duration and the deadliness of wars have all been going down. If you multiply those numbers out and just look at the total number of people who have been killed, you see there's a lot of ups and downs, but the last quarter of the 20th century is the has the lowest death rate of 500 years. We can now zoom in on the last 100 years, where the data include not just great power wars, but wars involving all countries. And here's what we see when we blow it up. There were certainly spikes corresponding to the period around World War I and World War II, but since then there has been an unusual period of lack of major wars. This is what historians have called the Long Peace, the fact that since 1946 there's been a historically unprecedented decline in interstate war, that is, a war of a country against another country. In fact, the most interesting statistic from this period is zero. That summarizes the number of wars between the two greatest powers of all, the United States and the Soviet Union, contrary to every expert prediction that World War III, led by the US and the USSR, was inevitable. No nuclear weapon has been used since Nagasaki, again, contradicting every expert opinion that a nuclear war was inevitable. There have been no wars between any two great powers since the end of the Korean War in 1953. No wars between any two Western European countries, which nowadays almost seems like a boring, obvious, trivial fact. Like, who would ever expect, say, France and Germany to fight a war? But needless to say, this is historically a very unusual state of affairs. Prior to 1945, Western European countries alone started two new wars a year for 600 years. As of 1945, that number fell to zero. And there have been no wars between any two developed countries. As of the top 40 or so countries with the highest GDP per capita, no two have fought a war against each other. Again, it almost seems obvious now. We think of wars as things that take place in those poor southern backward parts of the world. But for most of human history, it was the rich countries that were always fighting each other. And because rich countries can afford big destructive armies, when they fought a war, it could do a lot of damage. Well, what about genocide? It's sometimes said that more people were killed in the 20th century through genocide than through war. That is, countries, governments killing unarmed civilians deliberately instead of governments killing each other's armies. Sometimes you even hear that the 20th century was the age of genocide. But historians who have looked at genocide over the centuries are adamantly deny that claim. And one of my favorite histories of genocide was written by Frank Chalk and Kurt Jonasson, who I believe taught here in Montreal at Concordia University. And on page one of their book, The History of Genocide, they wrote, "Genocide has been practiced in all regions of the world and during all periods in history. We know that in ancient times, empires have disappeared and that cities were destroyed, but we do not know what happened to the bulk of the populations involved in these events. Their fate was simply too unimportant. When they were mentioned at all, they were usually lumped together with the herds of oxen, sheep, and other livestock. Looking at the available evidence from antiquity, one might develop a hypothesis that most wars at that time were genocidal in character." Well, what do they have in mind? Here are a few examples. If you believe that the events narrated in the Old Testament were accurate, then there was a genocide every few pages commanded by God, where he told the Israelites to wipe out the Amalekites, the Amorites, the Canaanites, the Hivites, the Hittites, and so on. Now, fortunately, those events almost certainly did not take place. On the other hand, they thought that genocide was a really good idea, as long as it doesn't happen to you. More historically accurate were the massacres of the Athenians in Melos, the Romans in Carthage, the Mongol invasions, the Crusades, the European wars of religion, and many episodes of genocide during the colonization of the Americas, Africa, and Australia. What about the 20th century? Is it true that the genocides in Bosnia and Rwanda mean that nothing has changed and the world has learned nothing from the Holocaust? Well, not exactly. Here are two graphs showing the an approximate rate of death in genocides in the 20th century. And there's no hiding the fact that there was a horrific spike of genocide in the centered in the 1940s. But since then, the trajectory, although it's been bumpy, has been downward. What about the rest of the world? Well, in a development that I call the new peace, the long peace seems to be spreading to the rest of the world. Now, I mentioned that since 1946, there have been fewer interstate wars, government against government. There have, however, been more civil wars, as newly independent states with inept governments defended themselves against guerrilla and insurgent movements. And during the Cold War, both superpowers armed and financed their client states, which increased the destructiveness of those civil wars. However, since the end of the Cold War, the number of civil wars declined too. And this graph will show the trajectory of the number of wars. For this graph, a war is defined as an armed conflict with a government on at least one side that kills as few as 25 people per year. So here we have the number of colonial wars. This, by the way, is a stacked layer graph where the thickness of each layer represents the number of wars in each of four categories, and the height of the entire stack represents the total number of wars combined. So here we have the number of colonial wars, which fell to zero in the 1970s as Portugal became the last European country to give up its empire. Here we have the number of interstate wars, country against country. Here, though, you see that there was an increase in the number of civil wars and the number of internationalized civil wars. That's a civil war where some foreign country butts in, and on usually on the side of the government. But we also see that the number of civil wars began a decline around the time of the fall of communism as well. But here's the key question. Which wars kill more people? The old-fashioned interstate wars or the more common nowadays civil wars? And this graph answers that question. It shows the rate of death in, first of all, in interstate wars from the 1950s to the 2000s, the rate of death from internationalized civil wars, and the rate of death from civil wars. So as you can see, the rate of death in interstate wars has plummeted. The rate of death in civil wars has increased, but not nearly to the levels of the old interstate wars. Now, if we combine these two figures, the number of wars and the number of people killed per year of war, we get the following stacked layer graph. Here we have the rate of death from colonial wars, the rate of death from interstate wars, which shows spikes for the Korean War, the Vietnam War, the Iran-Iraq War. Here we have the rate of death from internal civil wars and internationalized civil wars. The entire stack shows there's been a kind of a roller coaster over the years, but the trend has definitely been downward, and here we are in the 21st century with a thin layer showing that the rate of death in war has been at an all-time low for the period since World War II. Now, this graph comes from my book, and at the time, the data went up to the year 2008. You might ask, that was before the Arab Spring and the civil wars in Libya and Syria. What would happen if you extend the data? Well, I recently did that, adding data through the year 2012. And here you can see that there is a small uptick representing the rate of death in war, the wars in Syria, but it does not come close to the rate of death in earlier periods like the 1980s and 1960s. So what were the causes of the long peace and the new peace? Well, Immanuel Kant proposed three possible causes more than 200 years ago in his essay called Perpetual Peace, in which he argued that democracy, trade, and an international community all disincentivized leaders from dragging their countries into stupid wars. Since then, the political scientists Bruce Russett and John O'Neill have tested Kant's hypotheses against a large quantitative data set of militarized disputes, and they found that Kant got it right 3 out of 3 times. All three of these factors have increased in the second half of the 20th century, and all of them are statistical predictors of peace at a later period, holding all other factors constant. So here you can see, for example, the number of democracies in the world, which has increased since the end of World War II, and the number of autocracies has decreased. Here you have international trade relative to GDP per GDP, which has increased throughout the 20th century. And here you have membership in intergovernmental organizations, the United Nations, the European Union, and so on, also showing a steep upward trajectory. Finally, there are the rights revolutions, the targeting of violence on smaller scales directed against vulnerable sectors of the population, such as African Americans and other racial minorities, women, children, homosexuals, and animals. The civil rights movement in the United States put an end to the practice of lynching, which used to take place at a rate of 150 a year at the end of the 19th century. By the 1950s, that had gone down to zero. Since the 1990s, the FBI has tracked hate crime murders of blacks. Now, these are never very frequent in the first place. This scale is not number of hate crimes per 100,000. It is number of hate crimes, period. At its peak, there were only 5 a year. Even that number has gone down to 1 per year. Non-lethal hate crimes against blacks has also been in decrease, such as intimidation and assault. And the kind of racist attitudes that would license violence against black people have also been in decline. Here is the result of two sets of opinion polls that were given at various time periods since 1940. One of them asked, do you believe that black and white students should go to separate schools? The other asks, would you move out if a black family moved in next door? As you can see, both of them have been in continuous decline to the point where they are now in the single digits, and the Gallup and other organizations don't even include them on the questionnaires because the number is so low that it is in the range of crank opinion. It's like the same as were you ever abducted by space aliens. So it's effectively zero. There's reason to think that this is a worldwide phenomenon, not just an American one. Here we have a graph of the number of countries that have laws and policies that discriminate against racial minorities, like Jim Crow and apartheid laws, and that has been in a decline. The blue line shows the opposite, the number of countries that have remedial discrimination or affirmative action policies that try to help their discriminated against minorities. Now there are more countries with policies that favor their disadvantaged minorities than that discriminate against them. The women's rights movement has seen an 80% decrease in the United States in the rate of rape since the statistics were first kept, a similar decrease in the rate of domestic violence, and a decrease in the rate of the most severe form of domestic violence of all, uxoricide, the murder of a wife or girlfriend, and mariticide, the murder of a husband or boyfriend. The children's rights revolution has seen a decrease in corporal punishment, that is, schools that can strap or paddle a student. This graph shows the number of American states that even allow corporal punishment, which has gone from almost 100% to less than 50%. The approval of spanking and smacking and other forms of corporal punishment by parents has been in decline in every public opinion poll. Rates of child abuse are down, both physical abuse and sexual abuse. These are data from the United States. And rates of school violence, how often children get into fights, has gone down since the data first were collected. The gay rights movement has seen an increase in the number of states that have decriminalized homosexuality, both nation states worldwide and American states, which now stands at 100%. Homophobic and anti-gay attitudes have been in steady decline since they were asked on in Gallup and other public opinion polls. And hate crimes of intimidation against gay people have been in decline. Finally, the animal rights movement has seen a decline in hunting, an increase in vegetarianism, both in the UK and the US, and a sharp decline in the number of motion pictures in which animals were harmed. Well, the question now is, why has violence declined on so many scales of time and magnitude? One possibility is that human nature itself has changed, and somehow our violent inclinations have literally been bred out of us. Well, this is, I think, very unlikely. For one thing, we still see violence in children. The rate of violence in toddlers, two-year-olds, is almost half of two-year-olds hit, bite, or kick. In fact, I believe that those data may have been collected here by Richard Tremblay. Grown-up little boys and girls enjoy vicarious violence, such as in murder mysteries, Greek tragedies, Shakespearean dramas, video games, hockey, and movies starring a certain ex-governor of California. And then there are homicidal fantasies. A number of psychologists have asked people, have you ever fantasized about killing someone? And the results are that about 15% of women and a third of men frequently fantasize about killing people. And about 60% of women and three-quarters of men at least occasionally fantasize about killing people. What does this tell us about human nature? It tells us that 25% of men are liars. A more likely possibility is that human nature is and always has been extremely complex and has always included both inclinations toward violence and inclinations that inhibit or counteract violence, what Abraham Lincoln called the better angels of our nature, which I then used as the title of my book. And what has changed over history is how often our situations, our circumstances, favor the peaceable instincts. Now, I don't think there is any one thing called aggression, or I believe that the brain is complex and there are multiple reasons why people commit violence. There's sheer exploitation, the harming of a person that happens to be an obstacle on the path to something that you want, which results in rape, plunder, conquest, and the elimination of rivals. There's dominance, the competition among individuals to climb the pecking order and become alpha male, and the corresponding competition among groups for ethnic, racial, national, or religious supremacy. There's revenge or moralistic violence, the idea that violence is not just permitted, but it is mandatory. If someone has committed a sin, you can't let them get away with it. They must be punished, and that leads to vendettas, rough justice, and cruel punishments. And there are utopian ideologies of the kind found in militant religions, in nationalism, in Nazism, and communism, which justify violence by a kind of cost-benefit analysis. If you have a shared belief in a world that will be infinitely good forever, well, then you can commit as much violence as you want to bring that utopia to Earth, and anyone who stands in your way is the one thing that is preventing us from having a world that will be infinitely good forever. So how evil are they? Well, there's an old saying, you can't make an omelet without breaking a few eggs, forgetting the fact that human beings are not eggs, but explaining why, paradoxically, it is idealistic utopian movements that have been responsible for the most violent events in human history. Well, this sounds pretty depressing. What do we have on the other side to counteract our violent tendencies? What are the better angels of our nature? Well, there's self-control, circuits in the frontal cortex of the brain that can inhibit violent impulses based on anticipating what will happen in the long run. There's empathy, the ability to feel others' pain. There's the moral sense, a set of norms and taboos that regulate just what you feel comfortable doing or are ashamed to do. And then there's reason, cognitive processes that engage in objective, detached analysis. The key question now is, how do you bring the history back together with the psychology? That is, what has changed over history that makes our better angels more powerful? One possibility is that Hobbes got it right when he called for a Leviathan, a government with a monopoly on the legitimate use of force. Now, a state and judicial system with a monopoly on violence can neutralize the incentive for exploitative attack by punishing aggression and therefore canceling out the anticipated gain. That then calms everyone down because not only are you deterred from committing violence, but you know that your enemies are also deterred from committing violence by the government. And that reduces the temptation for a preemptive strike to wipe them out before they wipe you out. It reduces the need for a belligerent macho stance to prove the credibility of your deterrent. And of course, it reduces the need to actually carry out revenge after the fact. You basically outsource it and have the government carry out your revenge for you. Also, because we know from social psychology that in any dispute, both sides always think that their opponent's attacks are raw aggression out of the blue, but their own attacks are justified retaliation after the fact. If you have two sides both convinced that they are right, you can get endless cycles of blood revenge and vendetta. And having it determined by a disinterested third party, namely a court and judicial system, can nip that cycle in the bud. Some historical evidence comes from the pacifying and civilizing effects of states that I mentioned earlier, but also the fact that you can watch this movie in reverse when government retreats, leaving behind zones of anarchy, which are almost always violent, such as the American Wild West. If any of you have watched the old cowboy movies, you know that the cliche was that the nearest sheriff is 90 miles away, so you need to defend yourself with your six-shooter. In failed states, in collapsed empires, and in contraband economies like mafias and street gangs, which deal in the kind of business where if you feel you've been cheated by the other party, you can't press a lawsuit. If you feel threatened, you can't dial 911 and get the police to show up because what you're doing is illegal in the first place. So your only protection is a credible threat of violence, which explains why many of the most violent zones in the world today are zones controlled by drug lords and mafias and local warlords who control other contraband goods like blood diamonds or strategic minerals. The second possible pacifying force over history has been called gentle commerce, du commerce. The idea is that plunder is a zero-sum game. The gain from the aggressor is the same as or less than the loss from the victim, whereas trade is a positive-sum game, one where everybody wins. And as technology has improved, allowing goods and services to be traded over longer distances, among larger groups of people, and at lower cost, it becomes cheaper to buy things than to steal them, and other people become more valuable to you alive than dead. There's some historical evidence for this. I mentioned some of it earlier, that trade has increased during the era in which war has decreased. And at a more microscopic level, the studies have shown that countries with open economies and a greater dependence on international trade have fewer wars, have fewer civil wars, and have fewer genocides. A third possibility is the theory of the expanding circle. That is a term that was originated by the philosopher Peter Singer, but the idea goes back at least to Charles Darwin, which is that humans are equipped by evolution with a sense of empathy. Unfortunately, by default, we only apply our sense of empathy within a very narrow circle of blood relatives, close friends and allies, and cute little baby animals. But over the course of history, you can see the circle expanding to the village, the clan, the tribe, the nation, other races, both sexes, children, and perhaps someday even to other species. What expanded the circle? That's just the question that is raised in turn, and it's possible that the technologies of increased cosmopolitanism that I mentioned earlier are to be thanked. The fact that more people travel and know history and consume literature and drama and journalism suggests that as you start to imagine the lives of other people, you're less likely to dehumanize them. And indeed, some experiments have shown that when people read a first-person account of another person, even a fictitious person, they become more sympathetic to that individual and to the category of people that that individual represents. Finally, there's the escalator of reason, the possibility that with the growth of literacy and education and public discourse, people start to think more abstractly and universally. They rise above their parochial vantage point. This makes it harder to privilege your own interests over others. It encourages people to stand back and recognize the futility of cycles of violence, and increasingly see violence as a problem to be solved rather than as a contest to be won. Some historical evidence for the escalator of reason comes from the fact that abstract reasoning abilities, as measured by IQ tests, have increased over the course of the 20th century, sometimes called the Flynn effect, namely that IQ scores have been going up by about 3 points a decade throughout the 20th century. And other studies have shown that people and societies with higher levels of education and measured intelligence commit fewer violent crimes, cooperate more in experimental games, and have more classically liberal attitudes, like opposition to racism and homophobia and xenophobia, and are more receptive to democracy 10 years down the line, holding all other factors constant. Well, the final question that I'll ask is, if there are four different forces that have pushed violence down, why do they all push in the same direction? Why have we been so lucky? Now, I don't believe in any mysterious Hegelian dialectic or arc toward justice or cosmic force. Rather, I believe it's because violence is what game theorists call a social dilemma. Namely, it's always tempting to an aggressor to exploit a victim, but the damage done to the victim is always greater than the gain enjoyed by the aggressor. Now, since over the long run, aggressors become victims and vice versa, everyone would really be better off if, over the long run, they could all agree to refrain from violence. The dilemma is, how do you get the other guy to refrain from violence at the same time that you do? Because if you beat your swords into plowshares, but the other guy keeps his as swords, well, he could attack you at any moment. However, over the course of history, it's not unreasonable to think that human experience and human ingenuity have gradually solved this problem, the social dilemma of violence, just like we've dealt with other scourges of the human condition, like pestilence and hunger. And the common denominator behind those four pacifying forces is that all of them work to increase the material, emotional, or cognitive incentives of all parties to refrain from violence simultaneously. Well, whatever the best explanation of the decline of violence turns out to be, I think it has implications that are profound. For one thing, it calls for a reorientation of our efforts toward violence reduction from a moralistic mindset to a more empirical mindset. That is, instead of asking why is there war, perhaps we should ask why is there peace? Not just what are we doing wrong, but what have we been doing right? Because I think the data show that we have been doing something right, and it seems to me that it's extremely important to try to figure out what it is. Also, I think the decline of violence calls for a reassessment of modernity, of the centuries-long trend that has eroded family and tribe and tradition and religion, giving way to individual rights, cosmopolitanism, reason, and science. Now, everyone acknowledges that modernity has brought us many gifts. It has brought us longer and healthier lives, less ignorance and superstition, richer experiences. But there's always been a current of nostalgia and romanticism that has questioned the price. Is it worth it if we have to live under the shadow of terrorism, genocide, world wars, and nuclear weapons? However, if despite impressions, the long-term trend, though halting and incomplete, is that violence of all kinds is decreasing, I believe that calls for a rehabilitation of the ideals of modernity and progress, and it's a cause for gratitude for the institutions of civilization and enlightenment that have made it possible. Thank you very much. Thank you. Oops.
So thank you very much for this inspiring and enlightening presentation and for saving us tens and tens of hours of reading your book, which is very thick and very detailed, and you'll find much more information in this wonderful book. Do we have time for a couple of questions? Do you want to take some questions?
Fine with me.
Yes. Yeah. Okay, so we'll take two questions. So I've got one here. Can you please come to the front?
I can't believe that this question hasn't been asked, so you probably have a quick answer. But supposing, I have a question and a comment after. Supposing you did a meta-analysis, and instead of looking at the proportion of harm that humans do to other humans, you simply looked at the absolute number. And across a longer scale than the one that you're looking at the last 75 years, do you think that it's possible that although the proportion of harm we're doing is definitely diminishing, this is not because we're becoming nicer, but just that our population is growing faster than our absolute amount of harm?
Yes. Well, if the population was growing faster than the amount of harm, it would mean that we are getting nicer. Because every time a baby is born, that's a baby who could grow up to be a murderer or a dictator or a rapist. And so if babies are born that are not becoming murderers or dictators or rapists or violent husbands and so on, that would mean that we are getting nicer. I think the relevant statistic is always proportion of the population, because otherwise it would just mean the bigger the country, the more violent we consider it, which doesn't make any sense, because it would not take into account all the people who live happy lives, grow up, raise their children, and die without being victims of violence. But in any case, for the 75-year period or 67-year period, that's only for wars, because of course other data that I showed for homicides go back 800 years. But even for the war deaths, if you look at absolute number of deaths as opposed to per capita, the curves look more or less the same. The curves are tilted up a bit more because the world population has grown a lot in the last 67 years, but the curves still show a decline even in the number of absolute deaths. When you think about it, it almost has to be true. If you have, say, the Vietnam War, which killed probably 2 to 3 million people, and you compare it with a war of the Syrian Civil War, which killed 100,000, the world hasn't grown by a population hasn't grown by a factor of 30. And even if it did, the absolute numbers have gone way down as well. So I think relative rate is the relevant statistic, but for war deaths, even if you looked at absolute number of deaths, that shows a decline as well.
I don't think that quite answered the question, but let me make a comment that contrasts with it. You said that we're nice to puppies, and I want to suggest that if you look at the kill counter on the web, you'll find that as our population went up to 7.5 billion, it's gone up to 165 billion animals that we're killing to feed ourselves and entertain ourselves and clothe ourselves, and that's not becoming nicer.
It is true that probably the number of animals that have been brought up in unhappy circumstances and have lived shorter lives has increased, probably per capita as well. That's a case where I would say that the sheer numbers aren't a good reflection of the attitudes. Because if you look at, even though it is true, and from a chicken's point of view, this hasn't been a very good time to be a chicken, but that's a case where by increasing the number of poor people who can eat meat, we have also increased the number of unhappy chickens. But if you look at the number of animal rights, the number of bills have passed for the protection of animals, the number of regulations for the treatment of animals in laboratories, in corporate research, I think there the attitudes have definitely shown an increased awareness of animal rights, even though you're correct that by a sheer count of the number of animals, there have been more animal suffering now than there has been in the past.
Thank you for presenting an interesting argument about the decrease of modern violence. However, aren't you afraid that in the wrong hands, it might foster a sense of complacency on the behalf of governments or perhaps the public, just thinking that, well, there's less violence, so why worry about it?
No, I think it's the other way around. Well, for one thing, even if that were true, I think it's important to know what the facts are, to know what has brought down the rate of violence, given that it has come down. But I actually think that it's the other way around, that if people think that for all the efforts we have taken to try to make the world a more peaceful place, none of it has done any good. The world is as violent as it ever was, so why bother trying? Nothing that you can do will make any difference. You can get what's sometimes called compassion fatigue, like, why should I feel bad for the people who are victims of wars in Africa or Asia, nothing I can do about it. But what these data show is there is something you can do about it, or at least that someone has done something about. The rates go way down. We've been doing something that works, and so it's all the more important to engage in measures because they work. Otherwise, you're just being a moralist without making anyone any better off, but you really can make people better off.
Alors, peut-être une dernière question.
You said that the violence towards, for example, towards people who were homosexual has declined, but like that seems extremely unlikely, except in developed countries, maybe like the United States. But considering like around the world, many gay people are still executed, etc. Like it seems very country specific.
Well, one of the graphs showed the number of countries that have decriminalized homosexuality, which is a reflection of the number of countries that do put homosexuals to death. And that shows there have been more and more countries that have decriminalized homosexuality. We don't have figures on gay bashing worldwide, but the fact that it occurs doesn't mean that it's increased. It just means that it's not zero. So unless you know how many gay people were assaulted in past years, you can't say, well, I read about one in the paper, therefore it's going up. You can't have a trend based on one data point. So it is true that gay bashing continues to exist, but I have not seen any evidence that has actually increased. And given that governments are less likely to put gay people in jail, that's a reason to think that it's decreased. Although it is certainly true that the rates are much worse in the rest of the world compared to the West, but I don't know of any data suggesting they've gotten worse in the rest of the world, just that they're still bad.
Alors, merci beaucoup, Monsieur Pinker. Encore une fois, merci beaucoup d'être venu.
Merci.